Hello, my name is Scott. I'm going to be your YouTube companion here for the next maybe hour or so. What I'm going to be doing on this channel is delving into metal albums. I'm going to be reacting to metal albums. They're going to be long videos. What I'm going to do to try to help you guys out with that is I'm going to put timestamps to my favorite songs in the description and in the comments. So that you guys, if you want to, you can fast forward to some of the songs that I really enjoyed, and probably some of the bigger songs, more well-known songs as well on the albums. But my aim here is to do reactions to albums from metal bands that are not necessarily the most popular bands. I want to hit up a lot of obscure, mid-level, and lesser known artists and give them some promotion and some shine on this channel. So I have to say that I don't make any money off this channel. These videos are heavily edited so as to avoid copyright issues, and I do give my commentary throughout the album reaction. So there's going to be some stopping and starting and some pausing, and I want to apologize for that up front. If you want to listen to the album in its entirety without me giving my feedback or my commentary, the original link to the album in its entirety is going to be in the description. So just go ahead and click that link, and you'll be able to enjoy it without me talking over it. So thank you for stopping by. If you have any suggestions for future album reactions, please put them in the comment section. Please keep the comment section civil, okay? I don't want any personal attacks, no trolling, no shit posting, just no irrelevant or trivial information, please. Put what you want to hear me do in the comment section, and I'll see what I can do. These take a long time to do, so yeah, I don't know how many I'm going to be able to get up a week, but you know, I'm trying this out, and I'm going to see what I can do, what I have time for, and see what sticks. So if you enjoy this video, again, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. That's it for the introduction. I hope you guys enjoy the video. Sup, YouTube? Today is going to be a very special day. This is my fourth album reaction, and this is an album that I'm super excited about. Found out about it on Angry Metal Guy, and my uncle Vance also recommended it. This is by a band called Slugdge, and from the description that I got, this is supposed to be like progressive death metal. I'm not really expecting this thing to be in the vein of like an Opeth, like early Opeth. Like, when I hear progressive death metal, and I think the guy said it was progressive technical death metal, I'm expecting something more along the lines of like a Cynic or a Blotted Science, something like that. And the album is called Esoteric Malacology. I'm going to go ahead and research what malacology is, because I want to be able to understand the album better. That's why I do that. Oh, of course. Yeah. It says here that malacology is the branch of zoology that deals with mollusks. So I might just put a picture of a mollusk on the right-hand side. Yeah, we're talking about snails, slugs. Yeah, so the backstory behind this band is it was conceived, apparently, as a kind of a comedic take on metal. And the idea comes from these two guys having like an imaginary, like a religious belief, basically, in worship of an imaginary cosmic monster slug god called Mollusca. So that's kind of where the theme of this music is supposed to come from. Yeah, so this is pretty cool. This is something that you don't find every day. I'm really excited to hear how this sounds. Again, this is Slugdge. Esoteric Malacology. The first song is called War Squids. That's pretty funny. For any of you Black Sabbath fans out there. I'm going to play the song now. Blown away so far. I don't even know if I can analyze this shit. There's so much going on in every song. There's just so much going on in the music. It's not as noodly as I expected it to be. And a lot of it, some of the riff writing reminds me of Septic Flesh. Maybe it's just the guitar tone that the guy's using. But there's really cool, there's a lot of really cool things going on here. I remember in the beginning of the song, first of all, the song started out with an excellent, excellent riff. Like, right up my alley, definitely, you know, death metal. And then after that, the guitarist started playing this really cool melody. And at the same time, the drummer was doing all of these really interesting, like, cymbal hits back and forth. And I really liked the contrast and sounds there. That sounded really cool. And then they kind of, a la Dark Fortress, they brought in some of those really discordant sounding, kind of ominous, clean choir type vocals. I don't know how to describe them, but it's almost like I said in the Dark Fortress video. It'd be like if you took a bunch of regular ass people who don't really have any training in how to sing properly, and you brought them together into a studio and had them sing some kind of strange, ominous type of melody or tune. It just sounds really off-putting. After that, that was when I really felt some of the more standard death, like modern death metal riffage came in. And that's why I evoked the name Septic Flesh. Because just the sound of those guitars and the chords that they were playing, it just reminded me of something that you would have heard on Septic Flesh's last album, Codex Omega. Yeah, so far, got a little bit of everything going on in here. A lot of different things happening. So, can't wait to really get into this album, you know, and just see what's behind some of these song titles. So I actually think that reviewer was not completely wrong, but I think they were at least partially wrong, because at least in this song, man, I heard a lot of black metal in there too. Especially like the last minute of the song, the way it closed out. Tell me that doesn't sound like, you know, I don't know, pull a name out of a hat, right? Any like modern black metal band. That's just very strange, but there's stuff that sounds like that in here. There's stuff that sounds like Aborted, like that kind of gore-centric death metal in here. It's stuff that sounds like Septic Flesh. There's just a lot going on here, man. This is going to be really difficult to try to break down and analyze, because the music is just so dense and there's so many different influences, you know, coming in all these different directions. So, do I like the song? The song was captivating. You know, the song held my interest the entire way through. I can't wait to hear what else is on this album. I'm not quite sure if it's a song that I would, you know, put on my phone and play over and over again, though. Yeah, I'll just have to see. But I'm still trying to get used to what this band is doing. Trying to get acclimated. It's like when you first jump into a cold swimming pool, right? You've got to kind of wade around a little bit and get used to the temperature before you can really start swimming around. So that's kind of where I'm at. But we got the second track here is called Crop Killer, as opposed to Cop Killer. I don't know, was that an NWA song or what was that? I think it was NWA. Or maybe it was Public Enemy, I'm not sure. But anyway, so we're going to play that song. You can tell these guys have a sense of humor, but riff central in here, man. Good God. There's so many riffs in these songs. So many just really technical, like make your head spin kind of riffs. And I loved that riff that they started out the song with. It sounded almost like something from The Contortionist, specifically the album Exoplanet. I think that came out in like 2009 or 2010 or something like that. Only that album was a little bit deathcore. This is like the technical death metal version of that. I don't know if I would call this tech death, but this is definitely the death metal version of that. I think too, I'm really glad that they were willing to repeat that riff, because I think a lot of these artists that are more technical, I think they have a paranoia or a fear about being too repetitive and about using certain riffs more than one time. These guys were willing to use it again, you know, and to repeat the way the song started. That riff came in, sounded like the contortionist for a little while. Then the rhythm guitar came in, it sounded kind of heavy. And then after a while of that, then it went back again to the original, to the way the song started. And yeah, I'm glad that they're willing to do that kind of thing, because like I said, a lot of bands that are extremely technical, I think they get a little paranoid. So what you'll end up with is you'll have a song that's not really a good song, but it's got a really badass riff in there somewhere. And like, you remember that song because you remember how awesome that riff is, and you just want to hear that riff. Then you actually listen to the song in its entirety. You're like, man, this isn't a good song. You just listen to that part, and then you just like skip on to the next song, you know? So it's like so many of these artists, they don't understand. It's like you could take something like that and you can build an entire song around that, and yeah, it's going to be repetitive, but it's better to have a repetitive song that's actually decent to or good, you know, that's like 4 or 5 minutes long, than have a 5 minute long song of one good technical progressive riff in there amongst a lot of, you know, just nonsense. Again though, there's this music, there's so much going on, it's really hard to kind of break it down, but I'm going to do the best I can. I'm going to continue here. Okay, so that kind of makes me mad. The end of the song, it's definitely building up to something. And it's definitely going to transition cleanly into the next song, almost like it's a single song with a partition. So that's kind of a bummer that I have to stop it right there. But I totally get where these guys are coming from, man. The entire, like, the music sounds to me very, obviously it's technical, but it's also a little bit sci-fi. And some of the riffage sounds a little bit digital even. Like it sounds, there was a section in here, let me see if I can play it for you guys, where the... You hear that? That doesn't even sound like something that you would hear with a band like Animals as Leaders or any of these other gent prog bands. It doesn't sound like that. To me, that sounds like something pulled straight off of, like, Sega Genesis or Super Nintendo. You know, that I remember that old X-Men Sega video game that I used to have. That sounds like something off of there. Like, this is very digital, futuristic, sci-fi. I totally get it. Like, I'm there with these guys 100%. And if I met these guys, I think that we would get along really well, because this is this kind of shit, like this Phantasy Star 4 shit. This is what, you know, this is like my childhood. This is like home for me, are those types of sounds. A lot of people don't like to hear that kind of shit in metal, but I totally get where these guys are coming from, man. This sounds like a couple of sci-fi nerds who just are really into this little special, unique theology and mythology that they've created with the slug deity, Mollusca, and their music it harkens back to a lot of that, like I said, kind of digital, kind of science fiction-esque, a lot of those themes and motifs, and it's very technical. Like, I love this kind of stuff. Like, I will go to bat for this kind of stuff. So I'm really, and that song, Crop Killer, man, on top of that, like, there's so many good riffs in here, man. There's the guitar, the riff writing is just out of this world. They're so creative with their melodies, and there's so many different sections in this song. I can't even keep track of them. I can't even go into the different sections, because it just comes by in such a blur. It's like trying to react to something like this is just, it's really difficult, because, like I said, it just goes by really quickly, like it's a blur, and you're not quite sure what the hell just happened. But you know it was awesome, like, and I remember certain parts of it, but it's so much all at once, it's really hard to kind of analyze it and slow it down and break it down. But yeah, I feel like I totally get where these guys are coming from. So I don't know them personally, but I can tell by their music, I can tell we would have a lot of good conversations, me and these two dudes. I'm gonna start this next song. It's called The Spectral Burrows, and that's probably a joke or play on words, but I'm not quite sure what it's referring to, so. Not as technical or virtuosic as, say, an Archspire or a Necrophagist, or like a Planetary Duality or something like that, but it's fucking, it's close. It's very close, though. Yeah, I was really thrown off guard by those clean vocals all of a sudden. It's like, where did those come from, man? If they can lay down some really good clean vocals along with the growling, and I like the guy's growl, too. He's got a really deep, you know, menacing kind of growl. And if they can lay those down with the clean vocals, and then you add the music, the musicianship itself with the technicality and the abundance of good hard riffs, this is going to be, you know, something to behold, man. This is straight up. This is one of the coolest things I've listened to all year. I'm not saying it's better than everything I've listened to, but it's definitely one of the most fascinating things I've heard. Yeah, some people, man, I read that the drums are programmed drums, that there's not actually a drummer in this band, and they're programmed by the same guy that plays guitar. So if that's true, then that's amazing, because these drums are probably somebody who's got a better ear for drums would be able to pick that out. But to me, it sounds like a human is back there playing them. It sounds, you know, they're varied, they're complex, you know. And if it's true that the guitarist for this band programmed the drums as well, that's even more amazing. And the fact that there's only two people in this band, it just blows my mind, man. Just some people, you realize, you're like, damn, some people are just way more talented than you are. I know it sounds sad to say that, but dude, like, if I played guitar for 100 years, I'd never be able to write original stuff like this. You know, much less program the other instruments, and it's just, I'm blown away right now, man. Again, this song sounds like it's ending, but it sounds like it's building up to something else, like a crescendo. So I think I'm getting the feeling like all of these songs are actually connected, which is really cool. But man, I don't see how you could be a fan of extreme metal, specifically death metal and progressive metal, and not like that song, man. The Spectral Burrows had everything that you're looking for, man. It had imaginative leads and melodies. It had infectious, head-throttling grooves. Just powerful. So making me go like this. It also had really good clean vocals thrown in there too. And some growls that'll rattle your bones, you know? Some deep gutturals in there. And the way the song was structured, again, like, I'd have to be able to listen to it again to be able to really break down, like, the different sections and how they were organized and which ones they repeated and all of that stuff. But it was a song where it's 5 minutes and 49 seconds. It definitely, it seemed like they did a good job keeping the structure of the song interesting and keeping the music varied. That clean vocal, for example, that clean vocal at the end, that's something that you would hear on a chorus. Most bands don't put that at the end of the song. They put it in the middle of the song, or they put it, you know, they'll do it the first third, then the second third, and then that's it. I think they only repeated that part twice in the song, but yeah, when you get to the end of the song and you've got that, those cleans come in again, it's just like the cherry on top of the song. You're like, really? You're gonna do this again? I can't believe that. It's crazy. Like, this song was spectacular. I can't say enough good things about this song. This Crop Killer was good. I think the Spectral Burrows was even better. Yeah, I'm just super impressed. I'm just going to admit, guys, I'm having a lot of trouble providing cohesive analysis on this album. There's just a lot of information flying at me at once, and I think it's going to get a little redundant for you guys to hear me say, well, I really liked the riff on that song. Did you hear how many cool riffs were in there? I mean, these guys are highly skilled musicians, and, you know, it's technical, progressive death metal. So there's going to be good riffs all over this thing. And that's to be expected. So I'm going to do my best. I'm going to try to describe what I'm hearing and how I'm feeling without using too many cliches or becoming redundant. But yeah, it's going to be really difficult. So I just want you guys to bear with me. And I'm going to play the next song now. It's called Slave Goo World. It's the fourth track on the album. They took a break so I could pause the song. Damn, man. I was enjoying that a lot. This song reminds me of like a more interesting Black Dahlia Murder. With some clean vocals thrown in for good measure. This is incredible, man. This is as good as any death metal that I've heard. Especially that's come out in the last 5-6 years. This is pretty fantastic, man. The riffs are just nasty. It's super good for headbanging, but it's also really technical, and I'm just in love with this right now, man. This is how I want my death metal to be played. It's almost like back when I was in college, I used to think about, like, man, wouldn't it be really cool if there was like a death metal, technical death metal type of band that focused on, or that the theme of the music was like insect life. I know it sounded really weird. It sounds, or I should say, it sounds weird to say that, but I remember thinking that in my, you know, 20-year-old brain, like, man, that would be kind of cool. And then Blotted Science came out, right, with that album that was all themed about insects. I can't remember what it was called. I think it was called Anatomy of Entomology. And so my, you know, my silent wish to myself, it was answered. And then I thought, man, wouldn't it be cool if there was a metal band that was very technical, that sounded, that was basically steeped in extraterrestrial and alien type of mythology and culture. And then that silent wish was answered whenever I first heard Rings of Saturn. And that was an incredible listening experience for me. And there have been some other ones just throughout my life where I've wondered, I'm like, man, wouldn't it be cool if there was a band that was like that or that did that? And then I'll find it. It's really weird how that happens. But this is giving me that same feeling. Like, this is the band that I was looking for in this genre, in this subgenre, that I didn't know that I was looking for. And now I've found it, and it's like, holy crap, man. Like, some of my favorite albums of all time have been progressive technical death metal, and that's what this is. And it wasn't something where I was walking around thinking about it, like, man, wouldn't it be cool if there was a band that came along that had that style and played it at an elite level? Here it is. And it's like Christmas, man. This is so cool. I can't say enough about how skilled these musicians are, especially the guitar player. Whoever the guitar player is, man, is shredding. Yeah, I'm really enjoying this. I'm going to finish out the rest of this song. Oh my God, dude. Okay, I can't lie. I have to be honest. That is the best song maybe that I've heard this year. And I don't know how else to say it, man. I was blown away by that song. Not only is that maybe the best song that I've heard this year so far, but and it's only April, so I don't feel too like I'm too far out on a limb saying that. But not only is that the best song that I've heard maybe this year, that's one of the best death metal songs. That's got to be in the top 50, man. It has to be. Like, just name me another band that could pull that off. Like, if you took any of these other death metal bands, and with the exception of a few, man, who's got the technical chops to pull that off? Cannot undersell what these guys are doing. And there's only two guys in this band. Man, that was so cool. And I really enjoy, too, the classical influence. The influence from classical music that's in some of these riffs, man. It sounds like technical death metal and classical music were made for one another, man. Anytime that a band has incorporated that sound, whether it be Necrophagist or Archspire or these guys, and I'm sure there are others that I'm forgetting, but anytime one of these bands incorporates that sound, some of those scales, those classical sounding scales, it just sounds so cool, man. And metal, it's a really mind-blowing kind of experience where you're like, damn, I didn't, you know, you don't hear stuff like that very often, so it just sounds super cool. This song, Slave Goo World, the Spectral Burrows, and Crop Killer are all excellent. Slave Goo World is definitely the best song on this album so far. Spectral Burrows is pretty close, but Slave Goo World is in a league of its own, in my opinion. It's going to be difficult in my mind for them to be able to top that. But, you know, I'm not going to put it past him. It's just that was amazing. So I'm going to play this fifth track. It's called Transylvanian Fungus. 7 minutes and 29 seconds. This song is awesome too. I can tell they really tried to slow things down in this song. It's a bit of a change up from what they've been doing so far in the album, the last three tracks, and even the first track. This song, they're bringing it back down to earth a little bit, and it's really good. You know what that's interesting about this band is, again, the vocals, man, the clean vocals. Every time those come in, it's one of those moments that kind of makes my head spin, because that's pretty unprecedented in albums of this style. I mean, you had the Faceless back in the day, and Planetary Duality, to me, that's a tech death album. Even though people may not categorize the Faceless as a tech death band, they may say they're a bad representation of tech death. To me, Planetary Duality was a tech death album. And then even on Autotheism, there were still elements of that there. I know that Michael Keane, the guitar player for the Faceless, he likes to do clean vocals sometimes, but his voice sounds a little bit Broadway-esque. It sounds a little, I don't know how to describe it. It's a little cheesy, if I want to be frank with you guys. this guy's voice, it's not an incredible voice. It's not like he's blowing me away with his ability to sing, but at the same time, it doesn't sound corny on the song. It fits in the different spots of the song, but at the same time, every time I hear it, I'm thrown way off guard. I'm like, wow. You know, it's going to take some while getting used to that, but I think that part of the music, that vocal element, is just another thing that takes this album and this band over the top above a lot of their competition. Because a lot of death metal bands don't even attempt stuff like that, because they don't have the personnel. They don't have anybody who can do those types of vocals. That's why people like bands like Anal Nathrak so much, because that guy for Anal Nathrak, and I make the comparison between them and this band only because Anal Nathrak, as far as I know, is also a two-man show. And the guy that does the vocals for Anal Nathrak has a really cool singing voice also. And that kind of puts them over the top in certain ways. And I actually think that his vocals are a lot better than the vocals for this band. But what I'm saying is the principle is still there. You know, you have the super intense, extreme, complex style of death metal, and then the guy is singing, you know? When are you going to hear that? Almost never. I'm going to go ahead and finish the rest of this song out. Solo's done right. First time that the song ended so far, and it didn't sound like it was escalating and building to some climax, like right at the end of the song, so that the next song could start. The end of that song wasn't slow at all. I said that they were slowing things down, bringing things back down to earth a little bit. The end of that song definitely wasn't slow, so yeah, that was a badass song. As crazy thing is as badass as that was, I still don't like it as much as the Spectral Burrows and Slave Goo World. But that was Transylvanian Fungus. That was also an awesome song. That song, to me, instead of showcasing more of the technical virtuosity and being all proggy, that song sounded just more brutal. And the guitar tone that these guys are using sounds so rich. I mean, a lot of bands have really thick, heavy distortion, but particularly whenever those leads and solos come in, I mean, it's like cream. It's like butter whenever he plays it, man. It just sounds so sweet and creamy and smooth. I just love that guitar tone, man. I'm in love with it. That was another great song. So that's four in a row, man. Four excellent songs in a row. War Squids, maybe I'd have to listen to it again to really be able to appreciate it. But these last four that I just did, or that I just listened to, really made an impression on me. So we're going to move on to track six, Putrid Fairy Tale. This one is 6 minutes and 55 seconds. In my opinion, I was just thinking about this as I was listening to this awesome song right here. I was just thinking that, man, these guys dropped out of the fucking sky, man. Where did these guys come from? Apparently, I'm not the only one. A lot of people had never heard of these guys before this album came out. And apparently, they have a back catalog of, like, maybe four or five albums before this one. But they were largely an underground band, and they're very small, and not very many people knew about them, but a lot more people are going to know about them now, man. This is elite right here. If you like this style of metal, the super technical death metal with like a progressive tinge to it, this is as good as I've ever heard in that style. Maybe not as good as like Planetary Duality by the Faceless, and Cynic Focus is a classic, you know, in that style that I don't know if anybody's ever going to be able to really beat that album, but I'm speechless almost right now, man. And to me, if you're just talking about technical death metal, this is just as good as anything Obscura has ever done. This is just as good as anything that Archspire has ever done. This kicks bands like Black Dahlia Murder. This kicks their ass, in my opinion. And I know I shouldn't talk bad on other bands on this channel, because I want the channel to be positive, trying to deface other people's music. That's not what I want to do. But I'm just saying, man, people need to take notice of this album and take notice of this band, because if these guys can do it once, they can do it again. If they can come out, this is their fifth or sixth album. You can tell they've really hit their stride and they've reached maybe their prime musically, creatively. I have a good feeling about these guys. I mean, there's no way that they're going to make an album like this and then just fade into obscurity and you never hear from them again. That seems like a highly unlikely scenario to me. I did some research on this album, and everybody in the, like, this album kind of blew up in the metal blogosphere, man. Like, everybody covered this thing. Angry Metal Guy, of course. Invisible Oranges. No Clean Singing. Metal Sucks. Even Banger TV did a review of this. And Banger TV, they usually stick to more of the popular, obvious types of albums to review. Like, they generally don't dip their toes or dip their hand into the more obscure stuff. And even they reviewed this thing. And the guy that runs Banger TV, I think his name is Sam Dunn, but I could be wrong. Canadian guy, really cool guy. He gave this album a 4.5 out of 5. And he's an old school metalhead. Like, one of his favorite bands is Morbid Angel. And he listened to this and gave this, you know, like the highest score I've ever seen an album get on that channel. I think this is really good for the new school kids who like sort of the more modernized, digital, hyper-precise sound. But also, it seems like it's really impressing a lot of the older metalheads too. And I think that comes down to just the riff writing, man. These guys, the noodling in this album, it's not just noodling for the sake of. Like, it feels like the guitar passages actually mean something. And they're moving in different directions, but they're actually, and they end up always leading to some satisfying conclusion. And that's really refreshing, man. A lot of tech death, a lot of the really fast stuff, a lot of those leads you're hearing, man, they're just cool. They just sound cool, but they don't really fit compositionally. They're not really worked into the body of the song and of the music. These guys just have a very good grasp of how to be virtuosic, but also how to work in those leads and those scales and those guitar passages, that the more noodly ones that sound noodly, they know how to work those into the more standardized head banging, you know, blood pumping, throttling riffs also, that are to get you, you know, basically scrunching up your face and jostling your head around, that kind of thing. It's cool when you find something you really like, you just keep heaping praise on it, and you never get tired of doing that. That's I've reached that point with this album, and I'm like halfway through the 6th track, but I'm gonna go ahead and finish this. This is Putrid Fairy Tale. the very end of that song, Putrid Fairy Tale, the drums are going, and they had those clean vocals, and the guitarist in the background was going, you guys know what I'm talking about. Just the way they led into that, and then caught that little groove or section or pocket and just stayed there for the remainder of the song, man. They're flowing, they're moving from one idea to the next, to the next, to the next, and there's not a lot of repetition going on. And that last section there hadn't been used the whole song. And they just broke into it there at the very end. It just made me think, like, this guy who is writing these guitar licks and riffs, he has riffs for days, man. You know, there are guitarists who go their entire lives and without writing a really cool, badass sounding original riff. They just don't have it, man. Everything they do sounds derivative of something else, one of their favorite bands, but whether it be Sepultura or Morbid Angel or Machine Head or whoever it is. Nothing in here, to me, people may say, oh, that sounds like Black Dahlia Murder, oh, that sounds like Gojira, oh, that sounds like Septic Flesh or whatever, man, but to me, this is a highly, highly original album. And in the riffs, you can hear the originality, man. I can't place any of these riffs with any other band that I've ever heard before. They sound like certain things that I've heard before, but it's not like they're ripping somebody else off or like this is some derivative shit. This is good original songwriting, man. And all of you young metal guitarists out there, I know because I used to be one. All of you young aspiring metal guitarists out there, look at something like this, man. You wanna know what you should be modeling yourself after and following? Listen to this, okay? You could be like this one day. That solo that he was playing with all of the tapping and then flowed right from the tapping into some, you know, the more traditional soloing style. Like, all of that was just, like, perfectly executed. That's five songs in a row that have been excellent. So, yeah, I'm almost to the point where I'm running out of words. I'm having the same problem that I had for my Dark Fortress reaction, where I'm kind of, it's like being beat over the head again and again and again with how incredible something is, and you're just like, man, I don't know what else to say. Like, I'm just gonna throw my hands up and crawl into a corner somewhere with this album and just listen to it 50 times till I have the entire thing memorized. This is elite, for sure. And I stand by what I said earlier. To me, this is just as good as anything Obscure has ever done, anything Arch Spire has ever done. This kicks Autotheism's ass. You can add this, man, to the pantheon of excellent technical death metal albums, in my opinion. This is just fantastic. This is the seventh track. This is called Salt Thrower. have to admit, this song, until this last part, about halfway through, whenever this current riff dropped in, I wasn't feeling this song as much as the previous five songs. It seemed like it was heavy, and I appreciated that. And his low gutturals, man, they're so powerful and monstrous. That, I think that is basically why I kept comparing this band earlier to Septic Flesh, because he reminds me of the guy from Septic Flesh and his vocals, and how they're just so deep. They're just something to behold, you know? But again, this is a band that can give you Septic Flesh, like as far as the death metal riffage and the guy's growling. And then on the other hand, they can give you Archspire. There's just, I mean, how can you argue with a band that can throw both of those things in there, that's good at everything? It seems like, literally, I'm searching for a weakness in this band, and I can't find one, man. Other than, yeah, the guy's vocals aren't amazing or incredible or anything like that. Like, he's not going to make any money doing a cappella, obviously, but just musically, the instrumentation and the his growling again, man, it's just everything is so top-notch. I don't know how in the world these guys were like an undiscovered gem for so long. Like, this doesn't make any sense. This is almost as if, you know, an incredible five-star restaurant just fell out of the sky and landed at the end of your street in your neighborhood. That's how I feel right now, man. These guys just came out of the fucking sky. Where were they? I don't think that this guy's growls are going to get enough credit, man, because so much of the attention is going to be focused on the instrumentation. But again, his low gutturals, to me, they're excellent, man. They're superb. They're powerful. They're monstrous. They're good and phlegmy. They're really deep. And I just can't say enough about this band. I'm not super blown away by this particular track, and I think it's because of the way it's structured. I was a little bit ambivalent about the first half of the song and the kind of real slow chugging, you know, slow headbang that they were going for. Then the song went real soft for a minute and then broke into this current section we're in the middle of right now, and I love this. This sounds great. So I guess we'll see what they choose to stick with and what direction they go in for the rest of the song. But they haven't really laid a dud on this entire album. Like, even the other albums I've done, there's been at least one song where I was like, eh, not really feeling that one. Like, I guess if there was going to be a song on this album that was like that for me, it would probably be this song. But to be honest, man, they haven't really laid a dud on this entire thing. So I'm going to let the rest of this song play out.
Oh!
I can understand the esoteric malacology, you know, the study of mollusks. These guys, to me, like, are they mollusks? Are they snails or slugs or what are they, man? Because some of these melodies that they're writing sound like they couldn't have been written by human beings. They sound like they were written by some alien life form. It's crazy. And I'm not over-exaggerating. I'm not saying that it's superior to something that humans could write. What I'm saying is it just sounds really... I don't know how to describe it. It just sounds really strange. I'll play some of what I'm talking about so you guys know where I'm coming from. I'm not saying these people are higher than human beings. I'm saying that some of the stuff they write just... It makes you think, like, what the fuck is that, you know? What is happening right now? Do any of you guys out there feel weird as fuck when that's going on? That makes me feel weird, man. Like, I don't know what these guys smoke on a regular basis, but it ain't cigarettes. Alright, these guys are smoking something else. Maybe like ayahuasca on the weekends or something. This shit is crazy, and I don't know how on God's green earth I don't know how this album didn't get album of the month on Angry Metal Guy for the month of March, man. How did this not win? That is just crazy. The only way this could have not won is that the people there, not enough of them heard it, probably, is what happened. Because probably not all of them listen to every Tech Death album that comes through. They just don't care. They like other shit, you know, power metal, doom, death doom. Sludge, all that shit. So far, man, I'm really impressed. That song, again, I'm a little ambivalent on that track. I wasn't really digging so much the way it started, but I thought the second half of the track was really strong. So, yeah, but the thing about it is that there's so many other killer songs on this album that I don't really have to listen to this song and wait through those first 4 or 5 minutes just to get to the good part. Like, I have these all these other songs that I can listen to instead. So I don't think that that's a bad track. I think it is good, but I just think that, you know, from what I've heard up to that point from them, there are other songs on the album that I think I like a lot more than that one, even though that one did have its moments. I don't want to take that away from it, you know. So that was the longest song on the whole album. I'm going to move on to the final song. This one is the 8th track. It's called Limo Vincit Omnia. I have no clue what that means. So if you guys out there, you want to take the couple of seconds, I can't really do it because I have this camera here. But if you guys out there watching this want to take the few seconds and look that up and then put it in the comments section, that would be much appreciated. 7 minutes and 52 seconds. So here we go. This is the closer. We'll be right back. Yeah, now that I think about it, one of the reviews I read on this album said that there was a dodecahedron influence in here, and now that I think about it, I can definitely hear that in here. And those of you who know about dodecahedron and have listened to their albums, listened to Quintessence, especially, came out, I think, last year, you'll know what I'm talking about. It's just a weird low-end sound on the guitar, like the distorted guitar. It sounds almost completely like it's atonal, like completely atonal. And it's really strange to kind of describe, but when you hear that, especially in death metal, then automatically you're like, holy shit, that sounds like dodeca, because that's like their trademark sound. Yeah, there's a lot of that in this album, but I didn't pick up on that until just now. I was listening to the sort of the beginning of this song, and I was thinking to myself, yeah, that definitely fits. And this song, again, there's a heavy black metal influence in here. Sounds like black metal that I've heard in the past, and that's definitely not a bad thing, but again, that's not something that you would expect to find on an album that's been billed like this album's been billed, as like the next, you know, the next awesome tech death album. Most tech death doesn't really fool around with sounds from black metal. And if I'm wrong, if you guys have a example where there is a tech death band and there's plenty of black metal mixed in, just please let me know. But as far as I know, that's not something that's very common for this style of metal. So if you guys hear some ambient noise, I apologize. Someone's shooting fireworks off outside. Yeah, I'm really impressed with this song. I'm going to love listening to this. I cannot wait to listen to this album over and over and over again, man. This is going to be my new favorite album. Not gonna lie, I feel a little let down, not about that song or about anything else on the album, but I feel let down by like the last minute of that last song. Like, an album like this deserves the kind of phenomenal, heavy, technical, bombastic end that I know these guys are capable of writing. Something really intense to really close out the album well. It seemed like they kind of mailed it in like that last minute. Man, that's such a tiny complaint. Like, that was still a great song. That was basically, in my opinion, a black metal song. have the tremolo picking, and then they move right into a traditional blast beat. This was definitely felt like, and also the name being in Latin, I don't know what it means, but this definitely felt like a black metal song. Say something about that. Fucking, I wonder what would happen if Archspire had to write a black metal song. I wonder what would happen. And I will go out on a limb, man. I can't believe I'm going to say this, but I like this better than Archspire's last album that came out last year. That album's great, don't get me wrong. There's a lot of good songs on that album, but to me, man, this is some next level shit right here. This is incredible. And what's also funny is that there are so many bands in black metal and in death metal that are trying to be all satanic and dark and mysterious and all this shit. These guys, their whole thing is like slugs, right? Mollusks. That's the whole theme of their band. And they sound darker at times and more badass than many of the legions of other bands that take themselves so seriously that are trying to achieve the same type of sound in their music. And these guys are more talented than most of those bands. I really can't say enough about this album. I was so impressed with this thing. I will definitely be purchasing this album at some point. I don't know when, but I feel like I have to have this thing at some point. Like, I can't just listen to songs on my phone or whatever. I have to, like, be able to drive around and listen to this thing in my car, because this is definitely an experience, man. And for somebody that really likes technical death metal, man, you can't go wrong with this album. Like, this album is as close to perfection without getting there for this subgenre of heavy metal. This album is as close to perfection as you can get without actually getting there. And that's my opinion. Yeah, I would recommend this album to anybody who is into this style of music. If you guys have the money and you like this album, please purchase this album. Please support these two gentlemen. Because my guess is, unless they can find some really skilled stand-in musicians, these guys aren't going to be going on tour in your area anytime soon. Like, I read that the same guy who does the vocals and plays guitar also programs the drums, and like, how are you going to have a live show with two people playing music that sounds like this? You know, unless you can find some leftover band members from other tech death outfits, I don't really see how this is going to be possible to play a live show. So maybe they do play live shows and I'm full of shit, I don't know, but if you guys like the album, again, please support the band. Buy this album. Buy merch. Buy t-shirts. Buy whatever else they're selling. Don't spend too much money, but, you know, give them a little something back, because this is what this album is a couple of really smart, talented individuals, musicians that have probably been slaving away for years working on this project. And they finally hit their stride together, and all of their hard work and skill and talent all culminated in this album, and now they're having a breakout. This is their breakout album, and that's so cool, man. This album, I'm glad that so many different places covered this album, because it deserves to be covered, man. I don't see how you could be a fan of death metal and not like this album. So I'm just going to leave it at that. I have no idea what I'm going to do next. I'll have to think about it. I'm kind of conflicted. Do I go old school? Do I go new school? I really want to hit up more of the contemporary, current, modern stuff. But I also want to work through some of that grindcore stuff too, and do some classic albums as well. One album that I thought about doing, guys, if you like this suggestion, please comment. I like the idea of doing Gray Skies and Electric Light by Woods of Ypres. If you guys know about that album, if you know about Woods of Ypres, if you'd like to see that album reaction on here. I haven't heard the album. The only song on that album that I have heard is Traveling Alone. Outside of that, not familiar with the album at all. So, and that's supposed to be a classic. So if you guys would like to hear that, comment in the comment section below, And that's it. Really enjoyed this. Hope you guys enjoyed it too. And this is Metal Album Reactions. I'll see you guys next time.